to praise Him.
Please stand for the reading of the word.
Amen.
I will be reading Psalms 100. Shout with the joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before Him singing with joy. Acknowledge that the Lord is God, He that made of us and we that are His. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and go into His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name. For the Lord is good, His unfailing love continues forever, and His faithfulness continues to each generation. Amen.
Amen.
Please bow your heads and close your eyes. God, thank you for waking this morning. Thank you for letting us go to service today. Thank you for letting us have a great Sunday, even if it's cold outside. Thank you for letting us be here today and being safe to going to point A to point B. Thank you for what you've done, and thank you for all you've done. And please help the people in the hospital and help us, because we also need your help. And there's no limit to praise you, God, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
There's a leak in this old building, and my soul. Another year. My soul.
announcements of our own overhead and in your village.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day walk on water? Did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you've delivered would soon deliver you.
And then their son before the Lord our God. accompanied them in making this commitment. Godparent LaFlacia Fenoy.
I call your attention to the commandments of God as recorded in the Holy Scripture. Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 7 tells us, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up." Ephesians 6 and 4 says, "Fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord." God's instructions are plain. Parents Shamika Thomas Brisky and Deontay J. Brisky Sr., love God with your every ounce and fiber of your energy and teach your child to do the same. As you love God, you will model a wonderful love for God, and He will want for Himself. By coming forth before God and His people, do you hereby declare your desire to dedicate yourself and your son to the Lord? If so, please respond by saying, "We do." Having come freely, I ask now that you enter into the following commitment in the presence of God and His people. So that your child walk in abundance life that Christ offers. Do you vow by God's help and in partnership with the church to provide a Christian home of love and peace, to raise him in truth of the Lord's instruction and discipline, and to encourage him to one day trust Jesus Christ as his Savior? If so, say by "We do." Finally, I will remind the congregation of the old proverbs that says, "It takes a village to raise a child." Parents have first responsibility, but parents need the help and support of the church and community.
the next 60 seconds to tell God thank you for coming. Can we just take the next 60 seconds to speak well of your God? Oh, come on, come on, come on. You gotta open your mouth to be fed. You have to open your mouth, see? Chapter 4, verses 10 through 12. When you have it, say word. Exodus chapter 4, verses 10 through 12. But Moses said, "No, Lord, don't send me. I have never been a good speaker, and I haven't become one since you began to speak to me. I am a poor speaker, slow and hesitant." The Lord said to him, "Who gives man his mouth? Who makes him deaf or dumb? Who gives him sight or makes him blind? It is I," the Lord said, as we bow. Lord God, right now I need your help. I need you to pour in me the words that you would have me to say to your people, God. But I also need you to open the people's heart to receive, God. Right now we ask you to anoint this word and to anoint this place. Amen.
Amen.
I want you to help me present the topic of my message today. I need you to slap your neighbor on the shoulder just so the weave shakes loose a little bit and tell them, "Get your life." I didn't hear enough people. I said, slap your neighbor enough for the weave to shake loose just a little bit and tell them, get your life. Say that with some attitude. Get your life. In preparation for this message, I began to look at the life of Moses and the journey of the Israelites. And it brought back some memories of 2004 when President Bush was speaking and behind him there was a sign that says, "Victory is ours." Now, he was referring to the Iraq war that we were involved in. And the sign said, "Victory is ours." But yet and still, we fought for many years after that. How can you declare victory and you still have to go through warfare? This was quite interesting to me. I was like, "Lord, you know, why did you bring that into my remembrance?" And he said, "Well, look at the story of the Israelites." He said, Moses was sent to Pharaoh to declare victory. However, the Lord also said that Pharaoh's heart would be hardened. And then the Israelites got worked harder. They had to go through their war until finally they were released. And so I began to dive into this Iraq war. He declared victory in 2004. Victory was won in 2011. Now I did the math. I said 2004 to 2011. That's 7 years.
Well, work with.
7 is the number of completion.
Well, yes.
So God sent me on assignment today to let 7 people know that you're at the end of your 7th year and your victory is right around the corner. Now, if somebody really believed that, they'd be shouting right now. Because, see, on the 7th day, God rested. So that meant in your 7th year, you're about to receive rest. In 2017, it's your season of rest. Moses was sent to the Israelites. Now, who are these people that he was sent to leave the nation of Egypt? Who was he sent? Who was the people that God had assigned him to lead? The Israelites. Now, if we know anything about the Israelites, they were formed by Israel, whose former name was Jacob, whose dad's name was Isaac, whose dad's name was Abraham. So these people, these great men, left the lineage of Israelites. Now who was Abraham? Abraham was the source of a great nation. God let him know that you will have a great nation come from you. Who was Isaac? Well, Isaac was the channel of blessings that flow to the future generations. Because Abraham died, all of his blessings were passed on to Isaac. Now, who was Jacob, whose name was later changed to Israel? Well, Jacob is the promise of prosperity and increase. Now, you have these 3 great men that left the legacy for the Israelites, but they're in capture. They're enslaved by the Egyptians. How does that happen? Well, everybody died. Everybody that had went into Egypt with Israel had died and left the Israelites to fend for themselves. But what happened was the Israelites forgot who they were.
Well,
they forgot that there was a promise on their lives. And God tried to bring it to their remembrance because he kept letting them produce and be fruitful and multiply. And they were becoming numerous, and the Egyptians were like, oh, we're not going to have that. We're not going to have that. Okay, midwives, any male son born, kill him. But the midwives loved God, and so they disobeyed Pharaoh. So then Pharaoh was like, okay, I see.
Well.
Any firstborn son, any son born, any male born, throw them into the Nile. And then we come across a story of a Levi woman who had a son.
Well, yes.
And she named him Moses.
Well, yes.
And she saw that Moses was beautiful. And so she hid him. Now, how do you hide a male son? Well, God spoke to me and he said, favor isn't fair. He said Moses had favor on his life. When you have favor on your life, God will shield you. God will hide you from the enemy. When you have favor on your life, God has a way of making it seem that you are what you're not. So, I was like, well, Lord, did she disguise him as a woman? Maybe that's what it was. But anyway, he was hidden. And then once he got too big to hide, she put him in a basket.
Yes.
And floated him across the Nile.
Yes.
Now that That perplexed me a little bit. I said, wasn't denial the place where they were throwing in the boys to die? Wasn't denial the same place that was supposed to kill him? But yet, he was saved. His mother floated him across the very river that was supposed to kill him. That reminded me of another story. Do you know what story I'm talking about? Well, let's think about the story of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
The cross was meant to kill him, but yet he saved himself. Well, God saved him, and he saved us. See, Moses had a bigger assignment on his life, and that was to save his people. God had an assignment. Jesus had an assignment on his life to save us. Isn't it funny how God will use the very things that are meant to kill you to make you stronger, to make you move into your destiny and your calling? God is so good because he allows us to see death, but not experience it. And that very death leads us into our purpose in life. But some people have lost focus on their purpose, on their calling. Now, a calling is not the job you do. I found a way to define calling. Calling is customized life purpose that God has ordained for you to accomplish. If you're not bringing any glory to God with what you're doing, stop doing it. Because that's not your calling. See, when you step outside of your calling, you step outside of your destiny. And you become unfocused. You lose sense of self. See, what had happened to the Israelites, they had stepped outside of their calling. They were never meant to be slaves. How does a great nation become enslaved? Well, they lost focus. I summon to you today, church, don't lose focus. Get your life. See, Moses was a part of an elite group. He was part of the core. The Israelites were part of the crowd. Now, Reverend Simmons, what you talking about, the core and the crowd? Well, see, if we bring it into terms today, the core are people that show up Sunday after Sunday after Sunday. They work. They serve in the church. They give their first fruits. They tithe. That's the core. Now, we talk about the crowd. It's our CME Christians. Our Christmas, Mother's Day, and Easter Christians. Now, there's nothing wrong with being in the crowd because there's still promise. The Israelites still made it to the promised land. However, they never fully developed a relationship with Jesus Christ. See, the difference between the core and the crowd is that the core believes in the good times and in the bad times. But the crowd runs away in times of struggle. See, the core has an assignment from God on their lives. But the crowd is under the authority of somebody else's assignment. See, the core knows who they are. Wow, the crowd forgets who they are. The core never gives up. Wow, the crowd has no resilience. The core is bold and can walk into the face of adversity. Wow, the crowd is timid and shies away. See, the crowd becomes complacent and struggle. They become complacent in their trials and tribulations. They're the people that walk around, woe is me, day in and day out. There's never a good day. There's never a bright and sunny day. There's never a testimony. But see, the core can say, yea, you slay me, yet will I trust him. How do you trust when you're being slayed? That's because you're part of the core. You're part of God's anointed people. We need to begin to shift shift ourselves out of that crowd mentality and move into a core. Man, do I have any core members in here right now? Do I have any core people that can make the noise and aren't afraid of what the people around them are going to say? But know that because God is my king, I know that I have the victory. See, when you're the core, you've gotten your life. When you're the core, you understand your value. You understand your calling, which I defined as your unique life purpose ordained by God. But when you're crowd, somebody needs to slap you and tell you to slap your neighbor and say, get your life, get your life, get your life. Get your life. Get your life. So I was going further into the word, and I noticed that Moses took on a crowd mentality in the beginning. He said, God, don't choose me. I don't speak well. I have a stutter. I'm not worthy to do this. Send someone else. Send somebody in my place. I'm not the one you want. But see, aren't you glad that God is not intimidated by your weaknesses? God is not intimidated by the speculations. God is not intimidated by your flaws. When he has assigned you to do something, he'll provide the tools in order for you to do it. See, you walk in. See, when you're part of the crowd, you walk in with this defeated attitude. See, Moses was walking with the defeated, God, I have these flaws. God, I'm not there. I'm not ready. But God said, I am God. And I will help you to say what you need to say. But see, God took a little pity on Moses. And so he sent him a helpmate. His name was Aaron, his brother. See, sometimes God will position people in your life that will come and help you to fulfill your calling. And that's why I don't understand how people walk into service and can't speak, have a mean and nasty look on their face, because somebody right in the sanctuary could be that person positioned to take you to your calling. Positioned to speak on your behalf in order for you to reach your destiny. See, network increases your net worth.
Amen.
Somebody didn't get that. Network increases your net worth. What does that mean? Well, you might be applying for a job.
Man.
Somebody right sitting next to you might work for that company. You might own that company. You didn't even know it because you didn't speak. When you speak and you open your mouth and talk to that person and get to know that person, they can go and speak on your behalf and usher you in to that position. But if you don't speak, you don't know.
Say it now, say it.
A closed mouth does not get fed. So you have to open up your mouth, you gotta put a smile on your face, and you gotta network so that your network will increase. So Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh. And Aaron spoke on Moses' behalf. The Lord said, let my people go. Pharaoh said no. And then he proceeded to work the slaves harder, to work the Israelites to the bone. To say, I'm going to take away this luxury of bringing you the grain, and you're going to have to go get it yourself, and still meet the quota. When you feel like you're about to have a breakthrough, the devil has a way of making the situation even worse. But I was researching Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and I realized they all had a faith-growing process. That process included three major steps. If you have your pens, write this down. Because see, this is something you'll have to go through as well if you want to get to that core level. The first step is testing. There's a song that says it's only a test that you're going through. You're gonna get over real soon. Keep the faith and don't give up, because it's only a test. From that testing, it creates trust. Because though you're tested, God has still kept you. The Israelites didn't realize that even though they were being worked to the bone, they were still being fruitful. They were still prospering in the face of adversity. That they forgot that God had ordained their lives. But Moses had that trust. See, Moses was favored, and then he came back to the Israelites and told them, put your trust in God, for he will lead you out of here. But when it didn't come to fruition in the beginning, the Israelites said, God did not send you. I don't know, you just need to leave because you're making more work for us. They had lost trust. But see, the next step is resilience. What's resilience? That means to keep fighting, to keep pressing, to keep going. See, Moses could have stopped at the first no. Moses could have been intimidated by the Pharaoh's no, and he could have been discouraged by the Israelites coming for his life. But because Moses has his life, he kept going. He developed resilience, and eventually the Israelites are free. The issue, or the thing that was on Moses' life, was a prophecy. Moses is a prophet. And there's three things that go into prophecy. The first step is you have to prophesy it. Did you catch that? You have to prophesy it. Somebody say prophesy it. That means you have to see what you believe. See, Moses' prophet saw it when he saw the burning bush. God was speaking to him through a bush that was burning, but it wasn't burning up. That was the first step. You have to prophesy it. The second step is you have to prophesy it. Somebody say prophesy it. You have to speak life into your situation. The Bible tells me that the power of life and death is in the tongue. So if your tongue's not moving, you can't say nothing. But if your tongue is moving in the wrong direction, if you throw a shade, coming for people's whole entire lives, knocking people down, gossiping, what's that creating? You have to prophesy it. You have to speak your visions. You have to tell God what you need. The last step in this is to prophesize it. Somebody say prophesize it. That means you gotta take it. Because it's yours. Somebody just start taking some stuff from heaven. Somebody start taking some blessings. Pulling some blessings down if you believe it. You have to prophesize those things that you talk about. See, Moses did all of these things. He saw the burning bush. He told Pharaoh that God sent me to tell you to let my people go. And then he took his people out of Egypt. Are there some things that you need to take in your life? Are there some callings and some anointings on your life that you just need to start seizing? That you need to start saying? That you need to start seeing? I believe that there's about 5 people in the sanctuary right now that have a calling in their lives that they're not saying. And they're not saying it because they haven't seen it. And if they've seen it and they've said it, they're just not taking it. I need somebody just to start taking those things as which that you see. I want us to look at Exodus chapter 2, verses 16 through 22. This scripture says to us, sorry, technology breaking. Here we go. One day when Moses was sitting by a well, 7 daughters of Jareph, the priests of Midian came to draw water and fill the troughs for their father's sheep and goats. But some shepherds drove Jethro's daughters away. Then Moses went to their rescue and watered their animals for them. When they returned to their father, he asked, "Why have you come back so early today?" "An Egyptian rescued us from the shepherds," they answered, "and he even drew water for us and watered our animals." "Where is he?" he asked his daughters. "Why did you leave him there? Go and invite him to eat with us." So Moses agreed to live there, and Jethro gave him his daughter, Zipporah, in marriage. Why did I read that to you? I read that because your calling is preceded by kindness. You could be going through hell. You could be going through your trial and your tribulation. But if you just show kindness through that, you'll reach your calling. See, Moses needed to encounter the daughters of Jethro because the daughter that he got to marry, Zipporah, saved his life. Because on the journey to Egypt, God was about to kill Moses. It's in the text, you can read it. He was about to kill Moses. After God had just assigned him, given him an assignment, and he was going to kill him. Moses, I'm done. But Zipporah, the daughter of Jethro, saved his life. There are some people that are going to come into your life to save it. If you just show a little bit of kindness, they could be your lifeline. If you can just put a smile on your face, even when you're not feeling the best, somebody will come in and be that kindness. I think it's very interesting how the progression of Moses' journey to being the leader of the Israelites. And it reminded me of another story in the Bible talking about Elijah. Sometimes we aren't successful in our paths and in our journeys because we start talking to the thing before we start talking to God. See, Elijah had to talk to heaven first and tell heaven it doesn't need to rain for 3 years. So he had to talk to heaven first. And then he came down and talked to earth and said, there's not even going to be any dew on the ground. See, Elijah did the proper thing. We need to take some notes from Elijah. He talked to the heaven first. He talked to God first before he talked to his situation. Moses did the same thing. He had a conversation with God first before he went and talked to Pharaoh, his situation. If you begin to talk to God first, the situation that you're in will turn around. Because then you've got an authority and power from God in order to have the authority over your situation, all over the earth. Where we make the mistake is we forget that in the beginning was God. In the beginning was God. Not in the beginning was my mom. Not in the beginning was my dad. Not in the beginning was my grandma. In the beginning was God. We start speaking to other people first before we take it to God. There's no power when you just take it to other people. There's power when you take it to God first. Moses got his authority from God. That's why Moses could be bold when he walked up to Pharaoh. That's how he became part of the core. You become part of the core when you know that the order of operations is God first, man second. We need to understand that anything that we want to do, no matter how big or small, we need to take it to God first. Somebody say God first. So you can't get your life if you didn't take it to God first. You can't get your life if you can't speak to him, if you don't have a relationship with him. You can't get your life. You fall into that crowd mentality. But when you start to realize that I have to take this to God first, my life will be God. I want to close by saying, God has your back. And he won't ever let you go. See, God came to give us life and life what?
More.
He came to give us life and life what?
More.
See, when you have an abundant life, you live in joy. See, if you look at the Israelites, God said at the closing of this that they won't leave empty-handed. Look, I'm going to have the Egyptians give you the silver and the gold from them. They won't leave empty-handed. See, God doesn't want you to leave empty-handed. He wants you to live life and life. God got you. Somebody said it's a God got me. So how come I can't get my life? God got me and I need to get my life. Understand that I won't leave empty-handed. I may lose some friends. I may lose some family members. I may lose some other people. But God got me. He has greater in my future. The promised land is coming. It doesn't mean that my trials and my tribulations will stop. But it means that I can walk through them with boldness. I can walk through them knowing who I am. I can walk through them knowing that there's an assignment on my life. I can walk through them knowing that even in the bad times, God is still good. I can walk through them knowing that I'm part of the core. I can walk through them with my head held high. See, we're going to build resilience this trial and through this tribulation. We're going to build resilience in order to be able to lift somebody else up. See, Moses had to get over his insecurities first in order to cover the insecurities of the Israelites he led before. Be part of the core, people. Be part of the core. Understand that when you're part of the core, nothing. Somebody say nothing. Yell at me, nothing. Nothing is impossible. God bless you.